Good afternoon, everyone. Nice to be here. Thanks to the organizers of DevOx Ukraine. I'm happy to be here. And welcome to going from relational databases to databases with relations. This talk is going to be about Neo4j, a graph database, and the project I'm working on about Spring Data Neo4j. I have a short agenda for today. I try to keep as much content as possible into 1 hour. We speak briefly about the marketing slides of Neo4j, about my custom business domain, which I use to get myself familiar with the database. And then we discover how to get data into Neo4j, how to retrieve that. And then we end up with Spring Data Neo4j and discuss whether it's maybe a silver bullet to access different data stores and Neo4j. And we'll hopefully have some time to run some more advanced queries. So Neo4j. Neo4j is a graph database, a so-called property graph database. It's written in Java and Scala, runs on a JVM, and can be accessed from a lot of different client technologies. Did any one of you already work with Neo4j or a graph database? Wow. Nice. In production or just checking out? Awesome. Happy to hear. We call ourselves a native graph platform because we don't have an underlying different relational model or key value store model or whatnot. We store the graph natively as a double linked list, and we can traverse relations in O(n) time. Neo4j is also about a mindset, about thinking a bit different than about data than we used to in a relational world. In a relational world, we think about sets and whatnot. And in Neo4j, we think more about relations between data, between connected data. And there's also an ecosystem of people at Neo4j. Lots of engineers. We also have consultants for in-house projects. And I'm happy to be a part of the engineering team at Neo4j. This is my colleague Garrett. We together work on Spring Data Neo4j and our own Java Object Graph Mapper. I'm not that long actually at Neo4j, for nearly half a year now. I'm a Java champion. I run a Java user group at my place in Germany. So I have quite an idea what kind of effort is going into such a conference. And I also the author of 2 books. One was the first German book about Spring Boot 2. And the other one is actually about software architecture, how you can document big enterprise systems in a way that people can follow your structure. And that was actually my first contact with Neo4j. There is a cool tool called JQ Assistant that allows you to analyze an application, the classes and the packages and the methods and whatnot in your application. And it stores the data into an embedded version of our database, and you can do a lot of stuff with that. Check whether you violate package constraints or layer constraints or whatnot. It's a really great tool. I really recommend checking it out. But I'm also known for, and I know people here in the audience who have seen this talk, about Java and databases. I've spoken plenty of times about SQL databases, about object relational mapping, and doing all kinds of crazy stuff with SQL. And I wanted to talk, live with your SQL fetish. So I'm trying to be not known for fetish-oriented programming, but it was kind of cool that I ended up at a graph database company. So to get myself familiar with that one, I'm tracking my musical listening habits for quite some time now. Maybe some of you know Last.fm. That was a music service where you can track your music habits. I'm running this on a machine of my own for now 10 years. It's a very simple model, what we have here. I'm looking at artists, genres, tracks, and the number of times I played a track. This is a very simple entity relationship model, very understandable. But then came this guy here. Does anyone recognize him? This is Edgar F. Cott. He invented the relational model back in the 1970s. And he turned the nice logical model into those. Those is a table, obviously. But in reality, this is more than a table. This is a relation. those are the relations of a relational databases, relations between tuples. That's all there is. And in a relational world, we have a discrepancy between the logical and physical model. We design a logical model as an anti-relationship diagram and turn it into tables. And by doing so, we normalize all the data. Normalization is all about being free of redundancies. A data model is called unnormalized if I have dependencies between rows and non-atomic values in the tuples. The first normal form is having atomic data in your data sets, which I think is important also for NoSQL databases, because I think it's hard to query that stuff. Then we can go on second normal form so that we don't have partial dependencies between entities. My database model, which I've shown you, is not second normal form because I've stored the name of the album of a track with a track. So this is the interdependent, usually not the stuff you do. Then we have third normal form, and it goes on until seventh normal form, really sophisticated stuff, actually. But what's the key here is that if you design a relational model, you're not dealing with relations. Also not if you're doing foreign keys. Foreign keys are merely constraints ensuring that stuff is there in the other table. What are relations is a table and a query result. Now that's a bit different with a graph database like Neo4j. I like this, I stole this sentence somewhere. The whiteboard model is the actual physical model. Keeping in my domain, there are some artists. Maybe there are bands or solo artists. We support several labels per thing, per entity, or per node. Bands are usually funded in some country, or if it's a solo artist, most people are born somewhere. Artists are associated with each other. Bands have members. When I was young, artists used to release albums. Nowadays, they only stream stuff, but I think you get the idea. I can turn this model into something like this, and it basically looks the same. Going back, I have a logical model, describe it in a way that also my business people can understand, and I can fill it with real data. In this case, we're looking at one of my favorite bands of all time, which was Queen, founded in the United Kingdom, having four members, and released several albums, not only that one. So, back to the property graph. What we have here, those round ones are called nodes. They represent objects and therefore usually labeled with a noun. The relationship represent actions and therefore labeled with a verb. Both will be important. I forget to actually draw some brackets on the around there. And nodes as well as relationships can have properties. For example, the name of the singer, when he joined the band and when he sadly left the band. And if you understood that, you understood a property graph model. That's all there is to work with. But what we really got into Neo4j is how you query this. I know the people who run this into production probably have already seen our query language. Our query language is called Cypher. And Cypher is to Neo4j what SQL structured query language is to relational database. A declarative way to say what you want to have from a database and not an imperative way with other, like with some NoSQL database where I have to tell exactly the steps to retrieve my data, looking at some document stores. There's also OpenCypher to support the query language in other databases as well. I know that Redis supports OpenCypher and their new graph models as well. And there is the GQL manifesto, GQL standing for Graph Query Language, and this is an ongoing effort to standardize Cypher in a way like SQL. So how does this look like? Hopefully I don't fall down here. This is the same pattern I used to demonstrate the property graph. It's all about pattern matching. I want to match a node with a label album that has been released by a band And I also want to, coming from again a node, found it in somewhere, and also want to go from the band along the relationship of the members where they have born in. And I've added just a filter, a where clause, and retrieved the album, and then return all that stuff. This is quite theoretically. I'm going to show you a quick demo. Oh, nice. This is not that good. That should have looked better. Forget to start up my Neo4j instance. Let's take a second. Okay. So as I said, Neo4j runs on the JVM. Hope this it's a bit gray. And Neo4j comes with a browser interface that you can use to query your database instance. It also has a Cypher shell, much like SQL Plus, and it also has a tool which we call guides. I can run some tutorials to it. First of all, I can run a simple match query to see if I have any data in my database. Turns out there is not. Nothing there yet. Creation of data is pretty simple. Again, I have a pattern. Looks pretty much the same like the one I showed you on the slides. And remove that pin here. I cannot unpin this. Just found a bug. And there you have your first node. I just created a new node with two labels, artist and band, and a name. So that would be boring if Queen didn't release any albums. Create some more data. Now we have more inside the graph, the first relation. What we did here, we matched a pattern, a band, and then create a new pattern coming from an album called A Night at the Opera, which was released by the same band, and then return all the stuff. Queen had more than one album, and I can use also the merge statement. If I would run a create statement again with the same album, I would create the node twice because I didn't define any constraints on it. We do support unique constraints, indexes, and a lot of things more. I haven't defined any yet. So I use the merge statement, which checks if stuff is already there or not. So now I have, again, something that looks like two bubbles. And I can expand that. And you see I have two albums inside that one. I can go on further to actually create something I can make use of. I have this application that shows me how what's on my favorite track, but I actually want to analyze the data in a bit more detail. I thought of creating years and decades as entities in my database, because why not? I'm not restricted to a schema. So years obviously part of a decade, and then I use a merge statement to create or match an existing band and add the release year in this time to the album. Looking like this now. Graph starts to form. It's something you can easily discuss with a business stakeholder, for example, and modeling like ongoing. I'm going to skip that one. And what I have in the demo is analyzing of my musical genres. I think I tagged both the albums A Night at the Opera and A Day at Races with the genre rock again. What's notable here in this query is I can match a pattern at the top and filter it with a where clause and then use something we call the with clause. It is something like a pipeline. I can build up pipelines in Cypher query language to process my results step by step, which makes it really powerful to model your data. And we see how powerful this is in a few minutes. And I'm going to add this genre to the albums. So now we have two rock albums. every time I dismiss this view here, the data is not lost. It is stored in the database. It's just a representation on the browser is gone. To finish that, I add two countries, Great Britain and Tanzania. Tanzania is where Freddie Mercury was born. I again match the band at the country where the band was founded, and I add the artist, right? And return everything. Now we have the same schema which I had on the slides, and we are like 50 minutes in only. There is a way to retrieve the schema, and formatting that a bit or moving it around. Sometimes the browser forgets the style, or should need to forget the style. And that's basically the model I discussed in like 10 minutes now. And this is something I can query, which has a schema, which can have constraints. So we have all the best from a relational database and actually the freedom that non-schema databases give you. So while I did create some data with queries, it's kind of hard to do this all by hand if I'm speaking about a 10 years data set which I have in a relational database. So I was thinking how to do this. There's Neo4j ETL, which is part of our desktop distribution and which is targeted at like business analysts. You can pinpoint that to your SQL database. It retrieves all the tables, and if you have a good database design, it also retrieves the foreign keys. It turns each row of each table into nodes, which are labeled by the table name, and the foreign keys into relationships. That works fine. It's a good tool. But as I said, I had to learn and unlearn things, and I wanted to explore our product. And I found the command load CSV, and it's hard to see. It takes comma-separated values with or without headers, and you can use your newly cipher knowledge to get this into your database. That's not too bad. Load CSV is built in. It takes those files from HTTP file system or an import directory. You can define the field terminator. You can define whether it's with headers or not. And then you can just apply the cipher knowledge. This is the URL. The same cipher statements we just executed. And you get each line of the file as something you can dereference and work with it. When I first started it, I think having only that data, flat files, could not be that much. But if you work a bit with cipher, then you see that actually having one line and the modeling capabilities of cipher is actually quite powerful to do stuff. And yeah, some more highlights, and you end up with a graph like that. We will see this in a second in the browser in a bigger way. So I thought it was not good enough, and I said, I'm a relational database guy, I like SQL, and I think, why not building your own importer? You can extend Neo4j by custom stored procedures, much like some other relational databases. And our custom stored procedures are written in Java. And this is how they look. They are basic POJO classes. You get a custom annotation, which is called context. And you can get directly hold of the graph database service. And then you only have to declare procedures, giving a name and maybe description, whether you want to write to a database or not, parameters, and whatnot. And having a JDBC driver inside your instance, you can use, I'm using a tool called JOOQ here to connect against my relational database and retrieve all the data and map them any way you want. I think I may have overachieved that what I wanted to do. It's not actually necessary to do this. Because I learned about APOC. The creators of Neo4j are very fond of the movie The Matrix, which shows in the name. But APOC is not only that guy from The Matrix, and is also not that guy. That guy is Michael Hunger, friend and colleague of mine, who wrote large parts of a package of components for Neo4j or awesome procedures for Cypher, on Cypher, sorry. And this is what APOC actually is. It's a huge kind set of extensions for all things you can do with Neo4j, which include import-export, graph refactoring if you have to rename nodes and labels and whatnot, job management, also graph algorithms, but we do have a separate package for that. Yeah, and then I wanted to speak about that low JDBC tool. What it requires is a JDBC driver for relational database, and you can pinpoint it to single tables and get all the data from it, or you can use custom SQL statements to aggregate your data in front of it. So, and together with modeling that in SQL and Cypher, you get, at least to me, the best of both worlds. This might look shocking at first, but it is not that hard to understand. At the first statement, I define just a standard JDBC URL. At the end, there's URL. And then I have some SQL here, which basically does put my normal form 1 entity relationship model into normal form 2, because I extract all the albums over there, exclude compilations, add a whole bunch of joins way down there, and then I just run the same Cypher statements. It looks like a lot, it is a lot, but the results are really cool. This is actually the call statement where I call the loading of stuff. In a real-world application, you would have to configure, for example, the number of commits in between if you have a really, really huge data set so that you don't run out of transactional memory. So I'm going to show you this, because otherwise I would not have any data for interacting with. Again, I have some guides. By the way, those guides will all be on GitHub for you to try out. And that was the first one. I have to reset that style again. So I have two bands, Die Ärzte and Die Toten Hosen from Germany, Pink Floyd from Great Britain, and Slayer from the US and whatnot. That was the load CSV example. I skipped the simple APOC version and just run a little bit smaller the statement we had on the slides. This is all some ceremony. Oh, hopefully I didn't break it. Opening up, declaring a connection URL, declaring the statement, calling the stuff, and then the statements for creation, which he had earlier on the slides. Right. Run this. This takes a bit longer. I have a running Postgres instance on that machine here, and I just created from the data more than 1,700 nodes and some properties. If I look at the data, oh wow, what did I do? If I did, let's get some albums out of there. I can return not only the graph representation, I can query for properties on that one easily. Order by .name. And you get all the albums I have in my 10-year whatsoever. 10-year music history. So I also have the calls for my custom stored procedures, because they load the track data. I'm going to need them later on. This is how a call to stored procedures look like. It's actually the same like with APOC itself. This is going to run for a while. It's boring to watch this spinner. Let's see how to access that stuff. Excuse me, please. So Neo4j runs on the JVM. I'm a Java developer. I'm going to access it from the JVM. But you are free to use any ecosystem around that. We offer different endpoints. Neo4j can run embedded on the same machine as your applications. This is nice for tooling like JQ Assistant, but maybe not so much for big enterprise applications, because if the enterprise application crashes and it takes down your database, all kinds of bad things might happen. I don't recommend that. We also have HTTP endpoints, but what I want to prefer would be the binary bolt protocol, which is a highly optimized protocol for speaking with Neo4j, and it acts much like the same like JDBC does for SQL databases. And the drivers are available for Java, Go, C Sharp, POC if you want. We have a Python driver, which is actually quite important for data analytics, because and especially for machine learning, a lot of stuff happens in that area with Python. And there's also a JavaScript driver. So how does it look like if you interact with the driver directly? Pretty much as it would with JDBC. I open a connection to a Bolt URI, pass an authentication, and then get myself a database session, and that's about it. The drivers is result set and record oriented. Neo4j fully supports ACID transactions. I'm running in a read transaction here, and I return all the stuff, and that's it. That's how you would interact directly with the driver. That works fine on Java, Groovy, Kotlin, Spring, and I think we heard yesterday about Micronaut. It also works fine in Micronaut. As I said, I work at the Neo4j OGM, Object Graph Mapper. This stuff sits on top of the Java driver, actually also on top of the embedded version and the HTTP endpoint, and it copies ideas from JPR and Hibernate. It has a transaction manager to integrate with your application, with a session factory so that you don't have to open explicit driver sessions. And yeah, that's my day-to-day job. Neo4j OGM provides configuration, an annotation-based programming model to map between classes and your graph. And you can use domain-based data access and also the nice custom queries. So unified configuration is mainly about the transport mode, whether to use embedded, bolt, or HTTP, about the pool sizes, the driver does automatic connection pooling. Encryption is important too, and most important is where to find your domain model. This is unified configuration from OGM. Speaking of the programming model, we support annotations. I heard yesterday that some people think that Spring Data is leaky in the sense that several stores have different annotations. Different stores have different needs. Our entity annotation is called @NodeEntity. It supports the explicit declaration of a label. I use this because I named my classes with entity in the name. We have, I think I have this one. You have native references of IDs, and properties are mapped by the attribute name if you don't declare an annotation. I skip that. I think this is actually important to have as relationship annotation. They can be one-to-one, as in that one, and it can be one-to-many, as in that one, and they also work bidirectional. To be honest, if you don't like annotations, you don't have to use them with OGM. We can omit all of them, and we do our best to guess what you meant by declaring that graph model, or that domain model. If you have relationships that have properties like the membership, joined in a band and left a band, then there is a relationship entity for you. It defines the name of the relationship, a start and end node, and then the properties. We support custom conversions, like in that case, I'm using a Java 8 time type of year and do a custom conversion. Domain-based data access looks like this. OGM runs on JDK 11 without any problem. I have my demos set up on JDK 11. This is not JavaScript, this is Java. You create a new entity in this case, add some members, open up the OGM session factory, and then save the artist. I think I have the red ones there. Works the same with loading. You can query stuff by ID, like in this case. You can query all of the bands I have. And it basically, you don't have to work with Cypher if you don't want to. Deletion of stuff works as well. That one is actually interesting, the parameter at the end, because we don't have constraints on relationship. We could delete if you pick the wrong node and try to fetch it from the database, you can pull out your whole graph, which would bring down your JVM for sure if you have a huge data set. Or that would be even worse if you delete one node and traverse all the relationships and nuke your database and then call your DBA. So we provide depth, how far we want to fetch or how far we want to delete. So this is actually one of the reasons why I'm going to recommend using Neo4j repositories later on, because we expose that directly. So, and we can also use custom queries if you want. For example, give me all the British bands over here. And we support named parameters in query here. This says, give me all the artists that released an album which was released in the decade of 1970s by Queen. And again, JDK 11 compatible. So that one works with plain Java, obviously. Again, Micronaut, but Micronaut offers as well GORM, which is a cool framework. It works with Spring, and certainly with Spring Boot. But if you're already in a Spring system, and I understood that, like everywhere else, many people are on Spring. Does any one of you already use Spring Data? Okay, that's cool. You can use Spring Data Neo4j as well for our database. Spring Data itself is actually something like an umbrella project that transfers ideas from the domain-driven design book by Eric Evans to database access by dealing with domain entities with aggregate routes from a repository perspective. And Spring Data Neo4j is one of the stores and modules that are supported. It's actually one of the first Spring Data modules out there, the first version being like 8 years old, written by Emil Ephraim. This is the CEO of Neo4j, and Rod Johnson, this is one of the founders of Spring Framework, and is now built on top of the Object Graph Mapper, which means it is basically split in two, like Spring Data JPR, which is using JPR to do all the mapping and then only do the enrichment of queries, right? We are one of the community modules that is part of the official Spring release train, which is great. We offer the same convenient stuff like all the other modules, which are derived finder methods, custom result projection, and domain events, and whatnot. And for sure, we integrate it into Spring Boot. As I said, we can be used store agnostic, so you can use Spring Data Neo4j repositories everywhere where you use a document store repository or JPR repository. Okay, you don't have to use Cypher again, but you can use it also graph aware by, for example, limiting the fetch size and doing custom Cypher. So, revisiting the domain based data access. You declare in Spring Data repositories by just defining an interface that extends a repository, and that's all you need to do. You can opt to choose for Neo4j repository, which gives you all the CRUD methods you ever need, save, find by ID, delete, count, whatnot. And it also supports the depth annotation and depth parameter for limiting the fetch size. If you don't need this, I actually recommend not extending from Neo4j repository, but only the repository, or maybe the CRUD repository. Because if you extend from a specialized repository, then you're leaking, actually, the store you're using into your service layer. And you also have a very huge surface of RP methods. There's a lot of stuff in there, not only that, but many, many more. And with stuff that's already one time be out there, it's there to stay. Somebody will use it, and you cannot take it away without people complaining in your company, right? So the same example from plain OGM, where I dealt with OGM Session Factory, can be turned into that one, where I just create a new band, add members, and store it. And that's all I need to do. So this is a very nice and domain-specific way to deal with your data. The same for deletion, for example. If I find myself being embarrassed by a band, I just can delete it from the repository, right? Then we have derived finder methods. If I didn't convince you from using Cypher, you can do all the stuff you are used to by JPR and Mongo and whatnot. For example, I can find one album by name that picks out the name property and sees if there's one name is being unique in my case. I can find stuff by things matching a regular expression. This is run in the database. We support this natively. And I can add sort parameters and fetch size and whatnot. And what's nice feature is, forget the red line, is the find one by, and then you can traverse properties. The last method gives me all the albums that are written, released by an artist with a given name and matching an album name, so I can traverse properties many levels deep if I want. And you can also add query to define custom query statements. They are string-based. That's a bit sad, but maybe this will be changed so that you can have a type-safe query there. This one gives me all albums that contain a specific track. I think I have red lines. So this is actually quite nice. I look up all albums containing one track, matching the full path, and then restrict to the track having that ID. And this is very dense and compact. It would be at least double the lines if I write this down in SQL, I think. So also then custom query results. You declare them with @query_result. This thing is quite different than the entities. The entities have a life cycle. They are bound to your OGM session. They are managed. This stuff is not managed. This is loaded from the database, given to your service layer, and then forgotten from the session, which can be quite useful. And they can be used in all kinds of repositories over there as a return type over here. And this gives me all the tracks of an album. I have that one again later on, so I just skip over it. We support the transactional programming of Spring fully. You can use @transactional. You can also use a transaction template if you want to have more control about stuff, what's happening. So that's quite nice. So today in 2018, I wouldn't recommend doing any Spring project without Spring Boot. It's just too easy to get started. And we have the Spring Boot starter Neo4j. You add this as a dependency. You get support for those properties to configure everything you need. And what you also get is that one, the @data Neo4j test. Does anyone of you use the custom test layers in a Spring application? One? Only one? Hard to believe. I think they are pretty cool for testing every layer in your application separately. You can test your data layer. You can test your web layer, your web flux layer if you want. And they only bring up the components that are necessary for one specific layer. In this case, the repositories. And if you have an embedded instance on your class path, that one as well. So this is a test. So I try to not recommend silver bullets. And the don'ts for Spring Data Neo4j apply for several object graph mappers or object something mappers. This stuff is not meant for batch processing. If you try to get lots of data into a database, and I consciously say database, you don't want to go map that all to objects and then insert it. You want to grab the data and insert it and be good. You don't want that overhead. You should never abuse derived finder methods. I made this up, find one album by artist name, and live album is true, and released in value, blah, 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 blah. I've seen this in project, not that one, but I have seen these methods. Anyone want to read that? I don't think so. I would write a custom query for that. And most important thing here is don't follow your graph model blindly while modeling the domain. While a graph is tailored to answer specific question, or a relational database is tailored to fit set-oriented data in a perfect way, your domain, your use case, might be quite different. A simple example is, give me a list of all the artists in my database. Do I really want to retrieve all the albums and tracks they ever released? In the end, people start complaining, my application is slow, my database is slow. Yep, you're just retrieving stuff you don't need, you are throwing away. So, we see stuff like that. The artist entity having a relationship to all the albums. It's a direction which is incoming at this side. And on the other side, we have the albums, they have a relation back to the artist. So something we have to map. We can do this. It's not too easy, but it's doable. The album have tracks, and the tracks have a reference back to the album. A lot of stuff going on there if you retrieve this from a database. Doesn't matter if it's a graph database or a relational database. In the end, if you only want to see that, why just grabbing all the other stuff? So I would go with an approach like that. Model the artist like only having a name and relevant properties, and then modeling an album, for sure having a reference back, this is needed. And maybe don't even map the tracks. If my application doesn't modify them, why should I have lifecycle for it? Just take them as they are and display them. So, and then I then can use my derived finder methods like the one above. I hope I have a red line. Find everything by artist name, find all albums by artist name that matches some name, give it back, and there we go. And then if someone wants to see the details of the album, grab the details, and you're good to go. And this is where principles from domain-driven design comes into play as well. You want to keep your context as small as possible and understandable for your domain. We're all speaking about microservice, turning stuff into small chunks that are understandable, and we should start there and model this in the same way. So I give you a very quick demo on how to do this with Spring Boot. I have some minutes left. One way to do this is obviously this side. I haven't seen this today. Everybody knows that. Yeah, it looks synced though. You can search for Neo4j there and create a project. I already did that earlier. So all I get was this starter here, Spring Data Starter, Spring Boot Starter Data Neo4j, and I've added a web starter to actually present that stuff. That's all there is. Then I can configure my properties. Username is Neo4j. Password was music, which is the bold protocol on localhost. Oh dear Lord, I forgot the port. Well, a second, there it is. Didn't see this. I think it's taped. Anyway, and you can connect your application to your Neo4j instance. So, going to the applications, make it a bit bigger here. I promised we can write down stuff without annotations. Give it a getter. Then we can model the album. It also has a name. I'm just adding the getters. They are not needed for OGM and Spring Data Neo4j. They are needed for Jackson 2. I think I could have configured that, but I need them to display it as a JSON response. And add the relationship. test artist. And it's pretty easy to do. Released by. So I cheated. I added the REST controller. I'm not gonna hand code that one. But I have to add the album repository. I'm being a good guy here, extending only from the standard repository that should contain albums identified by some irrelevant native ID. And I'm just gonna copy of ops that method over here, give it albums, find all the stuff by a name, and we are good to go. Let's see what happens. Standard startup of a Spring application. Didn't take too long. And then I can query the stuff. Hope that works. Damn it. I forgot to add the ID field. Neo4j OGM actually needs this to identify these entities in our session context. So that was the error we just saw. Just reload it. And I get all the album screen have ever released. And it's that easy to model data. And to be perfectly honest, I don't see, apart from the relationship, anything where our store is leaking into the domain. So I think it's quite nice programming model. So I have like 12 minutes left. I have some more advanced queries. Neo4j is used in recommendation engines. I tried this. I'm not yet there. I've added some other interesting stuff. At the beginning, I've had added the genre rock to two albums, and I thought, why not visualize the genres I like the most? And turns out that I listened to a lot of rock music, and it was not what I wanted. So actually, it was not my idea. Michael Hunger gave this idea to me. Netflix is using something they called micro categories. They are combining something like science fiction with the release year and some other data to create micro categories, and they are much more expressive than only one attribute. And I did this with Cypher. This is, by the way, another character from the movie The Matrix. And just another guide to be ready. Then skip that one. So this is a real cool query with a lot of stuff going on there. We start again with a pattern, match everything, the A here, that has a genre. This is the first join. Then we go also from the same album over the year to the decade. These are two and three joins. I can even omit the label here. This is not needed. And then we have the fourth, fifth, and sixth join going from the same album to the artist and either to the country which the band was founded in or where the solo artist was born in. Then I have a restriction because I just broke my data minutes ago. This is not important. Then again, I have something cool here. I have implicit group by. I'm grouping by the genre, the decade, and the country, and create a frequency over that group, and then collect all the albums, all of them by the frequency, and return the stuff. If I execute it, make it a bit better, bigger, nicht better, I see clusters of data, which is a nice way to explore things. Too slow to make it bigger. So this has been 2000, Great Britain Rock. I combined the country, the year, and the genre to a micro category, and see that I listened to a lot of stuff from the 2000 released by Queen, Postmortem, obviously, also in the 90s. And this view makes it easy to spot errors in your data, because this actually shouldn't happen. I have this note here, which is Uma Guma by Pink Floyd. It's a very old album. It's actually from the 1960s and not from the 1980s. I might have bought it somewhere where it was incorrectly labeled, and I just tracked it that way. And I would never have spotted this arrow without this visualization. And I think it's quite a neat tool to use. Yeah. So putting it all together, I built my own personal music database from it, which is a Spring Boot application as well. As I heard yesterday from Ray from Google, this this is all I can come up with in designing, but I made it to the black bar at the top. So, for example, I have a query that returns all the years I prefer. This is one way of looking at the graph data. But you can also look in a more standard way at the data, for example, like just a tabular view, all the albums by Queen. And all that data is served from the graph database. This is my production data set. I have added some associations which I want to traverse. I added the members and whatnot. There's a crawler for Wikipedia in there, and all the albums. You can use that data in lots of different ways, not only to do visuals. You can use boring business application as well. What's relatively new in Neo4j internally is the support for spatial data. We support geographical and Cartesian points. Inside the database natively, we can compute distances between them, like I did for the Works Tour in 1984. You can query the data. This is all kind of musical venues. Ticketmaster has a nice API to grab those data in a JSON format. This is now queried by the polygon surrounding the venues. And I'd like to end this view with that one. This is the same query I fed in Cypher earlier, representing micro categories. And this is what you can do with Neo4j. That cluster here is German punk rock from the 2000s. So ending with this nice graph, there are some real use cases out there. Did anyone know the offshore leak data? This is something the Panama Papers and Paradise Papers have been huge convolutes of data. The Panama Papers being the bigger one from the 1970s until 2000s. They have been brought into digital form and analyzed by the International Consortium of Investigative Journalism, and they use Neo4j to find relationships between companies, individuals, lawyers, and entities who did some creative tax optimization, I'd say, whatnot. And Paradise Papers is pretty familiar. This one I like especially. This is from a German research center for diabetic research, and they're using Neo4j to find connections in medicine and biology. It's pretty obvious that stuff is connected in the medicine world, that medicine have dependencies maybe between certain stuff. And there's a nice article down there. You can try this yourself. We offer several things as a download. The desktop application is targeted more like a business for business analyst. And then we have Neo4j server, which is what I'm running on my machine, the community edition. And the enterprise edition is proprietary. It has some more features for clustering our graph and for backups. We have pre-configured data sets. There are some cool sandboxes We have the offshore leagues, and there's also stuff you can do with the kids. If I would think about exploring relational databases with my 9-year-old kid, he would label me crazy, but we have a Pokemon data set to play with around. You find all the relations between all the Pokemons and where they live, which is kind of cool also for kids. And to get this project, it's on GitHub, contains Docker Compose scripts to get you up and running in no time. The graph database is empty, but the full data set for my music data is in there. It also contains a Micronaut demo as well, so it's worth checking it out. And yeah, again, the resources. I've written some content in preparation for the talk, if you want to read up to that. Otherwise, I have to say thank you. And if you have any more question, feel free to ask over there.
Is it possible to use in this database the relationship inheritance?
Sorry, I didn't get this.
Is it possible to use inheritance in this kind of database?
Yeah, absolutely. This is a good question, actually. In the big application I've shown you, I have the artist entity, which has only one label, the artist, given here in line 35. And the band entity has two labels, which is artist and band. And we also support this without going through the annotations, by providing a set of labels on the class itself. So you have all the ways of building an inheritance tree, if you like.
I didn't saw it in Visual Instrument.
Okay.
I
can show you.
This Visual Instrument.
I can show you. This is easy.
Visual tool.
No, I'm match. What did I do wrong? Nah. What? What did I forget? I don't see it. Yeah. Okay. Sorry. You see here two labels, artist and band.
Oh, I see.
So you have all the ways of modeling stuff.
And another interesting question. How does this database solve the problem of isolation of transaction?
That is a question you would have to ask the database internal team. I cannot answer that.
Okay. Sorry. Thank you.
But I'm happy to check this out for you and just ping me.
Okay. The question is where to use graph database and when not to use graph database. What's the main reasons when we should decide to use the Neo4j or when we should use classic database?
Okay. I'd say give me a little second. It's easier to answer that with this slide here. Folie einblenden. You know, if you have a SQL query like that one, it works on set-based data, which gives me those charts. Then you win with a SQL database, because it's where they're really good at aggregating stuff. You have computing ranks and whatnot. If you are interested in finding out relations, go for a graph database. If you're interested in, for example, I have to take that one off. If you're interested in, for example, removing nodes from one another or another, or modeling cost relationships, or finding shortest path between nodes, I didn't even start to dig into graph algorithms. We have Dijkstra built in, we have A-star built in to find connections between stuff, go for a graph database. It's really, really fast because we don't have an underlying different model than the real thing. That would be my approach. But in the end, neither SQL or Graph database is a silver bullet. Right. Okay. Over there.
Yeah. A good question. When we're using Spring Data, Neo4j, right?
Yeah.
We sometimes write queries. So how could we test the SQL queries which we write with query annotation for Spring Data Neo4j methods? Sometimes we need to test that our queries perform correctly.
For example, if you're on Spring Boot?
Yeah, when we're using...
You would use data Neo4j test, and you get the repository, you get the Neo4j OGM session factory, and you can execute that in memory against the database. You have to make sure that you have some data in it to work against it.
So do we need to perform the actual insert or update with the real database?
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah?
You could perform it with the embedded version.
Okay.
A good way to test databases actually is using a tool called Test Containers. Check this out. It is available as a JUnit rule, which allows you to fire up nearly everything which is available as a Docker image. You get H2 database, you get Neo4j database as Docker, you get Oracle as Docker. Sorry, you get Oracle as Docker. And this is really neat with the test slices I just showed you. It works for all databases. And you can test your native queries there. Cypher or SQL doesn't matter.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. Over there, I think, before the king was out.
Thank you, first of all. Great talk.
Thank you.
Do you think there is a minimum size of data you need that using Neo4j or any other graph database pays off? Do you think, for example,
minimum size of data is interesting. If you want to see clusters of information, then I think there must be a minimum amount of data that makes sense. It doesn't make sense to work only with like three genres in my case, or with one big company in the offshore leagues. That doesn't make sense. You want to find, you have a huge, humongous cluster of data where you want to find clusters and maybe centrality points and whatnot, connections.
Yeah, that's why I was asking. Yeah. Would you, for example, do this demo you had here from a domain perspective, really do with a graph database?
Yeah.
Okay.
You see that in the genre query. And I could speak the whole day about it. I have connections between bands and whatnot. You have to add some data. I'm in the progress of writing a crawler for Wikipedia to do more with it. I think it already pays off with some entities I have here.
Okay, thank you.
Welcome. So, one last question.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
I'm interested. Our company wants to use the advantages of great graph databases, but we have a great amount of data stored in relational tables.
Mm-hmm.
Per month, we have about 500 million records.
Yeah.
And how much bigger or smaller will be that data in Neo4j? I mean the physical space, the first one. And if there will be any performance issues during queries of such a great databases from Neo4j side?
I cannot speak about the actual physical storage. It depends. Mm-hmm. It depends if you duplicate attributes or whatnot. And we have a highly optimized store. It should not be that much bigger. And all the join queries, which will be turned into direct lookups, mm-hmm. will be as fast or faster.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
So I think the next speaker is already waiting.
Yeah,
we can. Okay, one.
Yeah, the last question is about tools. Does it have some tools for migration or replication, something like this?
Yeah, in the Enterprise Edition.
Yeah.
It, we support a causal cluster mode, and this is replicated then. But that is a feature of the Enterprise Edition.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you for your time.
One small question.